I would like to welcome everyone to the third meeting of the Citizens' Participation and Public Petitions Committee in 2023. And I have apologies from Jackson Carlo. So as the Deputy Convener, I am convening today. Our first item on the agenda is to take item four in private. Are we agreed? Thank you. Our first continued petition today is petition 1948, improve the way that unexplained deaths are dealt with, lodged by Alex Kane. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to encourage Police Scotland to review their practices for dealing with unexplained deaths from initial recovery through to the support that is offered to family members. We are joined this morning by Stephanie Bonner. Stephanie is here to tell us about what changes she believes is needed, following her own personal experience. And thank you for the courage in coming to give evidence this morning. We appreciate you taking time to speak with us at the committee. Can I also welcome the members of the public to a gallery here who are here to support the petition and to support Stephanie. Stephanie, I do believe you have got a brief opening statement. Would you like to read it out, please, for the committee? And just take your time.
It's like a few pages, is that okay?
That's okay.
May I thank the committee for giving me this opportunity to speak and share my experience and journey with you. Before I continue, I want to assure you that the committee that I'm not going to go off track and intend to use this valuable time wisely, so please bear with me. I intend to cover the following. Who was Rhys Bonner? It was my son. What happened? What I believe went wrong? How this has impacted my family and I, and what changes could be made for the better. When I speak, you will hear my voice. When I speak, I hear my son, Rhys Bonner's voice coming within my heart. I'm sorry.
Okay, just take your time.
Hopefully both voices can be heard as one today. Hopefully changes can be made for the better after today. Who was Rhys? Rhys was my firstborn child. He was healthy, he was happy, and he was loved by his family and friends. He looked forward to living his life to the fullest and shared the ambitions and dreams of many 19-year-olds. But his life ended at 19, just before his ambitions and dreams could start to come to fruition. Rhys was a loving, caring boy. He didn't bother anyone, no one bothered him, and he didn't get into trouble. He was a happy-go-lucky teenager who had his whole life ahead of him. He had a career to establish, he had a future. He had true love to find and a family to build. He had his whole future ahead of him. Rhys was 19 years old when he was taken from me. The day he went missing was the day that my nightmare started and my world changed forever. The loss of a child is every parent's worst nightmare. What happened? Rhys went missing on the 24th of July 2019. His half-naked teenage body was later discovered on Thursday, the 8th of August 2019. Items of his clothing were scattered and missing. Police Scotland closed investigation into the death on Monday, the 12th of August 2019. 4 days later, but one full working day later, I believe this window of time speaks volumes. So that was one day spent investigating my son's death. My son's life was worth one full working day to Police Scotland. Just to repeat that, Rhys's half-naked teenage body was found on a Thursday afternoon and the investigation was officially closed on the following Monday. It was categorised as a missing person now found with no suspicious circumstances. My family and I were left to conduct door-to-door inquiries and build up a timeline of Rhys's final movements. We were also left to trace and secure CCTV footage and statements from different local sources. We discovered video footage of my son Rhys's body being dragged by ropes across open land in broad daylight by the police. This is 2 football yards. Open land. I will never forget seeing these images, as they will haunt me forever. The police didn't bother to try to prevent the public from filming this. If the body of a half-naked 19-year-old girl was discovered in an affluent area, I believe this investigation would have looked a lot differently. I believe the victim's family would have been treated a lot differently. I believe the approach from the police would have been completely different. What I believe went wrong, when a body is initially discovered, there is a vital window of time where important decisions are made by the police. At this point, if the police can't see any obvious signs of criminality or a clear cause of death, they have to make a decision despite the cause of death being unknown or, as they say, unexplained. In other words, the police have to form a theory based on what they see at the time of the scene, what evidence is clear to them, and what the circumstances seem to be. This is what the theory is often made without the cause of death actually being officially established, without post-mortem and toxicology results being conducted. In fact, the investigation into Reece's death was closed before he was even formally identified. I believe there is pressure on the police in terms of time and resources to make these decisions quickly and move on. And this is where mistakes can be made which cannot be undone, leaving families without answers and closure forever, leaving families tormented forever. I believe that postcodes play a significant factor in the decision-making and theories formed by the police. I also believe that what's going on at the time of the discovery influenced the police's theory. For example, in the summer of 2019, when Reece's body was discovered, there seemed to be a high number of suicide and drug-related deaths being reported in the media. Many of these were younger men. So when they discovered Reece's body in this postcode, given the climate at the point in time, I believe the police theory was drawn towards a suicide or drug-related death. I think the police thought, just another young man from a housing scheme who lost his life through suicide or an overdose. So let's not waste any time. Just close the investigation and move on. Police Scotland failed to fully investigate Reece's death. This is not my opinion. This is a fact, as it was upheld by Police Scotland within my complaint in December 2020. Police Scotland didn't even bother to conduct door-to-door inquiries. It's the basic stuff like this which could have made a difference, both in terms of securing vital evidence and in terms of trust and confidence in the police investigation. My family and I were left to conduct door-to-door inquiries and build up our own timeline of my son Reece's last movements. Police Scotland then failed to fully investigate my complaint regarding the four investigations into my son's death. Four key points were upheld by Park recently. How this has impacted my family and I am a mum from a housing scheme, a wee mammy from Ballanock, and I am not accustomed to talking to politicians, especially in such surroundings. I want to connect with you and describe my pain, the void left when a child or loved one dies, and there is no explanation given. I want to try to explain what it feels like when a loved one is the subject of an unexplained death. I would ask the committee to take a few seconds to think of someone you love dearly. Hold that image of that person in your minds. Concentrate on that person's image. Now, as distressing as this may be, imagine the police contacting you and informing you that the person was dead. Their body had been discovered half naked in open land. After the initial shock in my case, I felt like I had been struck in the heart with a bow and arrow straight through my heart. The first question you would ask is, what happened? You have lost your loved one. You need answers. You need an explanation. You need closure. You need this to start the grieving process and try to move on. But imagine there was no explanation given to you. Imagine how you would feel. You've lost your loved one forever and there is no explanation whatsoever. This is what the families face when they lose their loved one to an unexplained death. They cannot move on. They are left thinking about every possible scenario, night after night, week after week, as months turned into years. Imagine discovering that police had closed their investigation into the death of your loved one 4 days later, or one more keen day later, even before formally being identified, before a pathology report, before a toxicology report, before establishing a timeline of your loved one. Sorry.
Just take your time, sorry. Stephanie. It's okay, don't worry. You've got as much time as you want.
Imagine discovering that the police had closed their investigation into the death of your loved one 4 days later, one working day later, before the body was even formally identified, before a pathology report, before a toxicology report, before establishing a timeline of your loved one's last movements, before establishing who they were with or why they were with them. Imagine discovering that the basics like the door-to-door inquiries were not even carried out. I would ask you to consider how you would feel. Would you consider this to be reasonable? Would you accept this? In my case, I didn't consider this to be reasonable and I didn't accept this. So I made a formal complaint 3 years later and the complaint procedure has still not fully been concluded. This is all part of the journey I have travelled. Due to my son's death being unexplained, I still don't know with any certainty where my son's body was discovered. Police Scotland have at least two different sets of coordinates. I did try and lay flowers and tributes at location, only to be informed by the local people that I was at the lawn location. When Reese's body was found, I asked the police to show me where the body had been discovered. I wanted to know where my son took his last breath. I wanted to see where his eyes closed for the last time. As a mother, I wanted to know this, but I was paralysed by grief. A police sergeant ended up giving us a map with an X, marking the spot where Reese's body was discovered. Think about how insensitive this is. I would never have been able to find this, so my father asked the police sergeant to take him to an open space where Reese was discovered. The sergeant took him to an area and pointed, saying, "Just over there." Could I get a tissue if you don't mind, somebody, please? Sorry. This sergeant gave me misleading information and tried to obstruct me getting representation of my choice. I hold this sergeant responsible for causing me a lot of confusion, distress and anguish, and he is directly mentioned in my complaint against Police Scotland. Whilst this complaint was being investigated, this sergeant starred as a contestant on the Countdown TV game show, boasting about now being an inspector and being in command of officers in my area of the city. I felt physically sick seeing this man on TV, playing games while at the centre of a high-profile complaint and knowing that he had been promoted to the rank of an inspector. At this point in time, I have lost all faith in Police Scotland. No matter what they told me, no matter what they say, I will struggle to accept it as being credible. That's what happens when you're left without answers and given the wrong information over 3 years. So I have lost my son and lost my faith in the organisation which is there to serve and protect my family and I. To add to insult, I have watched Police Scotland repeatedly giving statements to the media about how sympathetic they are towards me and how much support they have offered my family. Every time I read this, I feel like I've been stabbing through the heart again. Police Scotland have not supported me in any shape or form. The second I made a formal complaint, they closed ranks and I met a wall of silence. I was offered to attend one meeting in December 2022 on request a PERT review. When I requested a PERT review, the meeting was taken off the table. I faced a wall of silence for another 2 years whilst the police continued to suggest otherwise to the media. I have faced obstructions, and my representative has faced obstruction after another. It hasn't stopped. After PERC upheld the four key failings, in fact, a few weeks ago, Police Scotland decided that they did not recognise my mandated representative. He had been mandated to represent me for over 3 years, but all of a sudden, he didn't recognise him. He put a formal complaint in and conducted PERC. Then they recognised him. So nothing has changed. Then they recognised him. He put a formal complaint in and contacted PERC. Then the police suddenly did a U-turn and recognised him. So nothing has changed. I believe that Police Scotland haven't learned from their failings and they resent the bad publicity they have received due to the way they failed to fully investigate Rhys Bonner's death, my son. Both my family and I have lost all confidence, trust and respect in Police Scotland. Bear with me, I'm nearly finished, thank you.
Stephanie, just take your time.
Thank you so much. Okay. What changes can be made for the better? When a body is initially discovered and the police didn't know the cause of death, a reasonable level of evidence should be secured if there are no obvious signs of criminality. This way, the police can go back after pathology and toxicology findings are available. The basics like door-to-door inquiries should never have been missed. So the window of time between when a body is discovered and a theory is formed and a decision is made must be looked and to be improved. Better to gather evidence and not to have to use it than not to gather evidence and lose it. Postcode policing has to be acknowledged and addressed. Every life matters, no matter what the postcode is. Right now, I don't believe that Police Scotland accept that postcode policing exists. Therefore, until they do, this problem can never be addressed. Do you really believe that if Rhys was the son of a lawyer from an affluent area, that this investigation would have looked different, would have looked like this? Police Scotland have not supported me or communicated with me or my family. Police Scotland have to support and communicate with the families impacted by unexplained deaths. In my case, they have spent more time trying to convince the media how much they have supported me than they actually have spent with me. Police Scotland have displayed more spin doctrine than sympathy. Finally, I believe that someone had a level of culpability in the death of my son. As the cause of a death cannot be medically determined, and as the police never fully investigated my son's death and secured potential evidence, I will never know with certainty what happened or be able to prove what happened to my son. This is the conclusion I face. This is the conclusion I have to live with every second. This is the conclusion I will take to my grave. This is what happens when a death is unexplained and a death is not fully investigated by the police. I want to take this time to thank you for your opportunity and your time. Thank you, each and every one of you.
Stephanie, can I say thank you very much for your opening statement, which I know must have been really heartbreaking and emotional for you to read out. Members have a number of questions they would like to explore, Stephanie, if you're happy, and I will start them. Stephanie, what are your main concerns about the current Police Scotland handling of unexplained deaths?
The impact on the families, it's so destroying. So destroying. I've got four other kids, and there's lots of people in my case that they've not got an Alex O'Kane in their life, and they don't trust, and it impacts the families tremendously. No one has any idea.
Thank you, Stephanie. I'll move to my colleagues. Carol.
Thanks, Stephanie. I really appreciate you coming along and sharing this with us. So I'm interested to know two things. Firstly, I wonder if you could tell me a wee bit about your experience of the postcode lottery that you felt it stands out in your statement. Have you made contact with any other families that have had this experience?
Yeah, a lot of families, yes. Okay. When the police said, where's you from? Where are you from? Kind of saying Berlin up, kind of went, oh, and I done, what is it? And they went, so why would your son be in Easterhouse? I went, because his college and different things is up there. That's why he goes. Oh, you don't get young boys his age, your boy's age, going to Easterhouse in different places like that. And I says, what do you mean? And they went, well, like it's just, it's different schemes and things. I went, I know, but I said, my son needs to go up there. That's his library and things. And I was shocked by that. I says, does it really matter where we stay? Then I stay in a back front door and, like, my house is decorated, fully decorated and things, and it's comfortable for my kids. So when they came in, they went, oh, and they went, what is it? They went, oh, we didn't expect, we thought we were going to be coming up a close. We didn't expect to be coming into a house. Oh, your wee house is nice. We didn't expect, we like that. And I was just taking back the kind of questions like that. And that's just got to be anybody's house and where they live and things.
Yeah. Okay, thanks for explaining that. Uh-huh. A wee bit. I appreciate you doing that. So if there was one or two or three steps that you thought would be important for us to discuss as change, what would those be?
Treat every life matters. Treat every life the same. They kept on saying, my boy never drank or anything like that, but they kept on saying, Will your boy be out? And I says no, he'll no boot my friends and that. I had to go and find out who my son was with, and it was a very bad person. But I've heard lots of things, other things have happened, and I showed the police, and sorry, but I was put after.
No, take your time.
It was a yes, Megan. Sorry.
It was just like if you had one or two things that you would like us to put forward as ideas to change the system at that very first bit.
I just had a wee baby. My wee baby's 4 months. A liaison officer summed it out with the police. I didn't. My son was missing for 15 days, and a police officer would only call me every two nights at 10 o'clock at night. Okay. And didn't interact with me. And I used to say, please, and no CID would come, but they would come to my house. And one time, it really impacted me, came a bulletproof vest. Mm-hmm. And I was really scared, and I'm just sitting there myself with my wee baby, and I was so shocked. And so I cried, and I went in being sick, and I went, sit down right now. And it was just the way I was treated. And nobody ever helped me. I never had any empathy or compassion.
That initial contact with the police. Uh-huh. Okay. Thanks very much.
None of us. And the CID never came and seen me, and I begged the CID to come and help me.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, David.
Thank you, Carol. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener, and Stephanie, thank you for your bravery today. That is much appreciated. You talked about in your statement about the feelings and the trust that has been lost, and I can very much appreciate that being the case. But what would you like to see improved with families? Because that's what you want to see here.
Yes.
That nobody else is put through the similar situation.
Yes,
that
I want,
you had.
I want it to be seen if it's unexplained and there's no circumstance. I want it to be treated as like a death. My son was found in open land, and I want no unexplained. I want it to be treated like as an investigation straight away, so they've got everything they need and things. I want the family to get a liaison officer. Okay. I think it really needs to be in, because they said you're dead strong and things, and they were making me feel, I felt, oh, I'm a strong mum, I don't need this, and that's where they made me feel. Mm-hmm. So, no, you really need one. I had a wee baby, and he was premature, and he wouldn't have met me, and it was so hard, so I was just clinging on to my baby. Mm-hmm. And they went, I said, so what does a liaison officer do? Oh, they'll just come into your life, and you don't really want people in and out your house and that. But I was not aware that a liaison officer was to tell me what was happening, and because it was only every 2 days they would phone me, they didn't want to come and see me. And I was looking for my son myself. No police were ever out. And they lied to me. They said 30 officers were going to door to door that day. Nobody went ever door to door. And he was only a wee 19-year-old boy.
So you really want to see that embedded in the process, that should be a liaison officer who is seconded and then given the opportunity to support and do support the family.
Yes.
Because you'd also talked about people closing ranks and trying to I don't know your view or your belief of that was that you weren't being given all the facts or you weren't being given all the information.
You just
and as a mother of a family, a grieving mother, that's so important that you are given that respect.
Yes.
And you are given that support because we have to trust organisations like the police to deliver that service for you. But obviously in this situation, that was a massive failing.
Oh, yes, very. Because I felt like a criminal. And I had my wee baby was only 4 months and they weren't understanding, it was premature, that I could have had other feelings come through my body and things and that and all. And they just kept on saying to me every day, where do you think? I said, my son's up the field. I said, I know he is, please go and help me. It's not that big. And I said, where is this lady in question? And they would say, it's okay, she's got a red alert on her if she goes and shoplifts or something. I said, but please help us, I've got kids and I'm terrified. I'm going to go and get, I'm going to get the CID in, investigate hard so you can get my son's, get my son back to me just now, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Fergus Sheehan.
Thank you, Convener. Thanks, Stephanie, for coming today. Must be very hard.
Thank you for the opportunity. Appreciate it.
But you're doing very well.
Thank you.
We appreciate it that this is, as you said, I think every parent's nightmare.
Yeah.
I think we all feel that very profoundly for you. Just, it does seem to me that you've been pretty badly let down, or very badly let down, by people that are supposed to help you. That's the way it seems to me. We haven't heard from the police, so we haven't heard what they've got to say.
Yeah.
But it does feel that way, I think, to me.
Don't communicate ever. I've got a representative, Alex O'Kane, and he helps me, and if it wasn't for him, and they've never tried to help me, they've never come out, and they just told me, my son, that happened, you need to accept that, and that's it.
Yeah, I think we heard Miss McCain was very helpful to you. So.
Oh, God, I wouldn't want to be here without him, I wouldn't.
And that was very good that Paul did that.
Oh, yeah, I'm so proud of Paul.
I'm not the same party, that doesn't really matter, but we can imagine that he would have done that.
Can
I just ask, and this might be too difficult a question to answer, but have you ever been offered any explanation by the police about why they didn't carry out the investigation that you felt was kind of basic, namely door-to-door inquiries and things of
Had an answer. I've got the park complaints in. When they came back, they uphold the 4 complaints that they dragged my son and different things, but I've never had any answers, My son just went out that day to go to McDonald's and I'm left with that. How can your 19-year-old boy go out on a lovely summer's day and they said there was lots of water up there? It's an open, the nurseries and that can walk through and it was really a really nice summer, so it was all very dry and things, and they never put any helicopters. And one day I said, because I was scared to speak up because I was, in case they didn't want to look for my son, so my partner said, what about, can you get sniffer dogs, helicopters and that? And they went, that's resources. So I said to my partner, which resources? Is that too much money in that? And my partner's like, but it's my son, you need to do something. No, there was never any officers.
Mm. We're not, our purpose is not to carry out an investigation. We can't do that. It's just, I feel guilty saying that, but that's just the way it is. We cannot do that.
I just want other families' help.
I can't start doing that now, and I'm not proposing to. But what troubles me about this is that, you know, the evidence we've had from the police, and they put in a written submission to us, basically says that they have a duty to provide family liaison support in certain circumstances. And my question really is, how did they determine why you weren't entitled to more support? Because, you know, if it had very clearly been a homicide or if there had been a fatal accident inquiry to be held, then the submission we've had is that there would be an obligation to provide support. But it seems in your case, from what I've gleaned from the evidence, that they decided that there really wasn't that obligation. And victim support also have said that they don't provide help. So it does seem that you kind of fall between the cracks here of the police and victim support. And
yes.
Do you have a sense of what you would like to have happened? And, you know, would you have liked the police to have done more? And are you able to say... What would have been better, you know?
Somebody come in my house to see me. Somebody to go through... it's nearly 4 years now, and when my son was just missing in the 15 days' time, that's the only time I've seen the police, and 2 months after that. So I've not seen the police or ever heard them for 3 years, just over 3 years. They don't talk to me. It's a wall of, just a complete wall of silence, and I don't know why.
So just the lack of communication was the kind of...
100%, no communication at all. No communication
was the
whatsoever.
Theme, and yes. no apparent desire to communicate.
Oh,
either.
No.
In fact, quite the opposite.
Yes,
Is that right?
That's right.
Well, that really is wrong, I think.
Yeah.
I would imagine that many of us here feel that way. So thank you again for answering my questions this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
Stephanie, before we draw the evidence session to a close, is there anything we have missed or you'd like to say?
See the video of them dragging my son? And I think something has to be done about that, please. Please, because it's on video. And they've not told me that's my son. And I want to know my son's body is, please. I'm begging. Because they won't tell us what it is. They won't tell me nothing. So I'm begging, please. Please help him and please help me a bit. And just a bit of empathy and some compassion for my wee 19-year-old boy. He did matter. He's beautiful. And can I tell you one more thing about him? He rescued away and he had a job right up to he passed away, the wee soul. He didn't drink and things and he never had a chance to. And he wanted his wee brother. I've got 4 other kids. And I'm scared. And the person still walks about the street. And I've got a large kind of family and things and all that. And I'm just left there, worrying every time the door knocks. I'm terrified.
Stephanie, can I say thank you very much for coming and giving us evidence? I know it's a real difficult time for you and it's difficult to reenact what you're going back through. Can I say also thank you to Public Gallery for coming here to support her and the petition? It's greatly appreciated. And can we suspend and to allow Stephanie to leave, please? Can I welcome everybody back to Citizens of Participation and Public Petitions Committee. The next item on the agenda is petition PE 1896, provide every primary school child in Scotland with a reusable water bottle lodged by Callum Isted. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to replace its disposable water bottles provided with primary school lunches with sustainable, reusable and metal bottles. We previously considered this petition at our meeting on the 23rd of November 2022, where we agreed to invite the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero Energy and Transport to give evidence to the committee. We have instead today the Minister for Green Skills, Circular Economy and Biodiversity, Lorna Slater, giving evidence on the petition. Thank you for coming to give evidence to the committee this morning. Members have a number of questions, but I do believe you have an opening statement, Minister.
I do. Thank you very much. I would very much like to add my congratulations to Callum for the considerable effort he's put behind this petition and the campaign, and for raising £1,400 to buy reusable bottles for his school. His work has been an inspiration to us all. I and this government are committed to this agenda and are seeking to dramatically reduce the amount of single-use plastic products that we consume and throw away in Scotland. That's why we are working hard right now to implement Scotland's deposit return scheme. We have banned some of the most problematic single-use plastic products and are introducing a minimum charge on single-use beverage cups by 2025. Scotland's deposit return scheme, which will cover the kind of single-use bottles that we're talking about today, will alone reduce littering by a third and cut emissions by the equivalent of 4 million tonnes of carbon dioxide over 25 years. That's an average of around 160,000 tonnes of carbon dioxide each year, the equivalent of taking 85,000 cars off the road in the UK. But I agree that is only part of what we need to do. Education authorities and schools have a key role in leading the way. Callum's petition has requested that the Scottish Government provide local authorities with funding to enable schools to give reusable metal water bottles to school children when they start in primary one. While I welcome the spirit of the request made in this petition and absolutely share the same ultimate goal, reducing to a minimum the consumption of single-use plastics in schools, it is for local authorities as autonomous and democratic organisations to agree their annual budgets, taking into account their statutory duties, national and local priorities. The law says that all schools must make sure that drinking water is available, free of charge, for all pupils at all times of the day, including mealtimes. It is for each education authority and school to decide how drinking water is provided, and it's important that we respect this so that they can provide water in the way that works best for their school and pupils. Obviously, the Scottish Government is clear that this decision, like others made by schools, should support our broader environmental goals. I know that those who provide catering in schools actively consider sustainability as part of their thinking about the delivery of their services. It is also reflected in the Learning for Sustainability cross-curricular theme, which encourages schools to take a whole setting approach to sustainability. This means that all school buildings, grounds, and policies within the school should support learning for sustainability, making sure the school is taking steps to be more sustainable, which includes reducing the use of plastic. I know that in practical terms, local authorities do use sustainable approaches to reduce single-use plastic used in schools. This includes the provision of water fountains, ensuring that water jugs and reusable cups are available in dining halls, and encouraging pupils to bring in and use reusable bottles. Further, in direct response to this petition, my colleague Shirley Ann Somerville wrote to the directors of education at all local authorities, drawing their attention to both the petition and their obligations to provide drinking water to pupils and further encouraging them to do so in an environmentally friendly way. We will continue to build on this progress. Thank you for inviting me here today, and I'm looking forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Minister. Several members do have questions to be answered, and I'll just start first. Is there any further engagement with local authorities, directors of education, following the Cabinet Secretary's letter regarding the issue raised in the petition?
I'm happy to pass that over to my colleague.
Sorry, following the letter, we have not had further engagement with directors of education in relation to that. As part of the preparation of the letter, we engaged with COSLA, the representative organisation for local authorities, in order to garner their support in the provision of the letter. And so we haven't engaged at this point in time with local authorities. That's partly also because there is an ongoing duty upon education authorities to provide water, and education authorities are also required to have due regard to any guidance provided by Scottish ministers in relation to the provisions for sustainability as part of the part of the Health and Nutrition and Promotion Act. That guidance has been in place for some time, and therefore we would regard that as an ongoing commitment and requirement upon directors of education, rather than something that's new and arising specifically in response to this committee.
Thank you for that. Karen Mochan, I do believe you.
Yeah, I'm quite interested to know, you spoke about the responsibility of local government to provide water for young people. I'm just interested to know to what extent that is monitored. Do we have any evidence that water is freely available, and how well young people get to access that?
So there is ongoing monitoring of the duties under the Act. So there's formal monitoring, and there are specific nutrition inspections as part of the inspection arrangements for schools. We also engage regularly with catering services and education authorities as part of our ongoing support for implementation of these provisions. This is an area which you will recognise is very important in terms of provision of food and drinking water. As part of our nutritional standards, those have been recently revised, so we have had significant engagement with education authorities in recent times around these. So we do have ongoing engagement in relation to this matter. So we are well cited on these provisions. I think our understanding of the position would be that there has, of course, been an impact to provision of drinking water during the COVID-19 pandemic, because there was specific guidance in place for education authorities at that time. That guidance has obviously come away, and we are aware that catering services are returning to what would be a more normal provision in schools. We are still engaging around that at this point in time in terms of our other commitments around provision of food and drink in schools.
Just one more. Do you know the balance in terms of, you talked about the change in guidance and stuff, whether it's disposable bottles that schools still give out or whether it's more sustainable?
I think the petition suggests that there is a single-use plastic bottle provided, certainly in Callum School. That wouldn't necessarily be the practice in every school in Scotland, so we don't start from the position that that is the practice in every school. I think we are aware that there are other approaches. So instead of bottles, there are reusable cups. There are cups made out of cornstarch. There are a variety of ways in which that happens. So it's not quite as the use of single use plastic isn't quite as widespread as might have initially been presented. I hope that's
thank
helpful.
You. Thanks.
Yes, thank you. Good morning. Good morning, Laura Miko. Just following on from Carol Mochan's question, I was pleased that there is monitoring of the extent to which schools provide water to pupils. I mean, what is the upshot? What evidence do you have from each local authority about this?
I don't hold specific evidence. As I indicated, it's through ongoing monitoring engagement through nutrition inspectors and through our ongoing engagement with catering services. We haven't done a specific exercise to monitor provision because it's a legal requirement of the Health Promotion and Nutrition Act and the specific regulations.
Well, if you're not able to say what evidence there is, how do you know that children get water?
Well, we know that from the discussions that we have with catering services and with education authorities. When you used the term evidence, I had been thinking more specifically of a specific exercise to undertake and establish the position in each education authority, rather than the evidence that we gather through our ongoing engagement with education authorities, which, as I have already said, is very, very regular. And we do have feedback in that
way. Well, I mean, obviously that's appreciated, but I mean, what Callum has asked for, and he's, you know, the minister said he's done well, I think we all recognise that, but basically what he said is that every primary school child should have a reusable water bottle. Now, I mean, if you have your own water bottle, you carry it with you, convener, you have that all day. I mean, anything else, whether it's a fountain or a cup in the canteen, you don't have. So, you know, we're fortunate here, we're privileged, here we are, we've all got water. But they don't have that in school. So the whole point is twofold. One, every child has access to water, and you say you don't know whether that's the case or not. And number two, the whole point of the petition is that that access should be done by means of a reusable bottle so that there is less repetitive cups, paper and plastic cups and so on, which are bad for the environment. So really, I mean, the sum total of your evidence is you really don't know what's happening and you haven't said yes to Callum's petition. So there have been warm words, but Callum hasn't really made any progress, has he?
I don't think that's an accurate representation of the situation at all. There are other sustainable ways of providing water, and it is up for schools to provide the way that works best for them. For example, if schools and local authorities have invested in water fountains and the maintenance and upkeep of those, that is how they've decided to provide that statutory requirement to provide water, and that is how they've decided to spend their budgets, and that is with them to make that decision. Equally with jug and cup schemes, they will have invested in that scheme, and that is absolutely within their, you know, purview to decide how to spend that money and how to make that provision. It's not for us to impose upon them how to interpret that requirement to provide that water. But we do know that water is being provided, as my colleague says, because of ongoing conversations that we have with education authorities.
Well, I'd quite like to see this evidence because it doesn't seem to me that there's clarity, and there really should be clarity from each local authority who should provide a simple explanation of what they do in each case. The last question I'd just like to ask is this, that, I mean, if every child were provided, convener, with such a reusable bottle, then, of course, that would enable a form of national procurement. And if a national procurement system is done for every local authority, then the way procurement goes is that you get a better price because you're buying many more of exactly the same thing, rather than have possibly 31 separate procurement exercises of bottles. So, I mean, have you actually considered, has the minister had advice about or sought advice about whether or not a national procurement scheme would therefore offer not only these cost benefits because you get cheaper unit costs because of larger procurement, but also certainty that children actually get access to a reusable source of water personally, which they can have all the time, and thereby answering Callum's petition and providing a certainty, near certainty, that every child is properly hydrated, which, with respect, Minister, you're not able to say at the moment.
Callum's petition is specifically about a proposal to replace single-use bottles, which was the situation in his school. Many schools already have solutions in place for this, for example, water fountains or jug and cup schemes. So there is already that provision in place. We're not wanting to solve a problem that has already been solved in many schools, and we know schools are working toward that sustainability objective. We also nationally have programs in place for tackling single-use plastics, for example, our deposit return scheme. So the process to move away from single-use plastics is well underway. I recognise Callum's hard work on this and the work he's done with his school, but it isn't the correct solution necessarily for every school and is up to schools and local authorities to put in place the correct solutions to them.
Well, thank you for those remarks, Minister, but with respect, there is no evidence that you have got, and I would suggest that you get evidence from each local authority to find out what actually is happening. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Fergus. Minister, I wonder whether a statutory guidance on nutritional requirements for food and drink in schools could be revised to address the concerns raised in the petition by Callum.
So the position that I set out earlier in terms of the requirements in the both in the Health Promotion and Nutrition Act and the Food and Nutrition Regulations are already aligned to ensure sustainability is considered as part of the approach to the provision of food and drink in schools. Therefore, we would not require to amend the regulation in order to address sustainability. or the use of single-use plastic, because that arrangement is already built in as part of the legislative arrangements that exist. As I've said, we have significant ongoing engagement with education authorities and catering services in terms of this issue and their arrangements for promoting sustainability.
Thank you. Alexander Stewart.
Minister, you touched on the deposit return scheme when Fergus Ewing was asking a question previously. So can I ask how the deposit return scheme would operate in schools and the impact that this could have on the use of bottled water?
Yeah, thank you very much. There's several different ways that schools may interact with the deposit return scheme. Large schools that have, for example, a cafeteria where they're selling drinks, they would obviously be part of the scheme in terms of they would charge the 20 pence as any shop or cafeteria of that style would. And then they have an obligation under the scheme to decide whether they are going to operate as a return point. So they have the same choice that any other cafeteria or similar venue would be to operate as a manual return point, to install an RVM to be a reverse vending point, or to apply for an exemption from being a return point based on health and safety grounds and some of the other grounds that are available for exemptions. Schools that do, for example, free school meals and provide a free bottle have a couple of options there in terms of either running as a closed loop system, like many restaurants will. For example, when you buy a bottle of wine in your restaurant, you don't take that bottle away with you, so you wouldn't pay a deposit on that. The restaurant takes that back. That's called a closed loop system. If schools were to offer an open loop system with free school meals, they would have to incorporate the price of the deposit into that meal, because this child would then be able to go away and collect that 20p when they returned the container themselves. So there's all different ways in which schools may interact with the scheme. Of course, if schools move away from using single-use plastics as a way of providing drinks, and specifically that water provision which they are required to provide, then they would not be required to participate in deposit return.
Okay. And is there any further legislation, either in Scotland or UK-wide, that has raised with the petitioner here? Because he's trying to achieve something. And we know there are other things that are trying to be achieved. And, for example, the Circular Economy Bill and the UK Extended Producer Responsibility, what impact could they have on this petition and the way things are planning to go forward?
The member raises excellent points. Those are exactly the sort of tools that we have in our toolkit as we move towards a circular economy and get rid of this waste, particularly the plastic waste, but waste of all materials and energy in our society is no good. I'll start with the extended producer responsibility for plastic. That is a UK-wide initiative. I think it was 2 weeks ago at committee we passed the SSI to start collecting data toward that scheme. From 2024, businesses will need to report large packaging producers on what their packaging is made of, how much packaging, that sort of thing, toward 2025, when they will pay fees based on how much packaging they produce, and those fees will be collected and distributed to local authorities to help them pay for recycling. So this is another one of these producer responsibility schemes where the cost of handling those materials at the end of their usage is going to be passed to the producers of those materials rather than being borne by the public purse. So that's a very exciting initiative and will, I'm hoping, transform our recycling and also the design of packaging and materials, because it will incentivize producers of packaging to use more sustainable materials, more recyclable materials, hopefully less material altogether, so that they can, it's advantageous to them to do that under the fee scheme. The other thing you touched on was the Circular Economy Bill. So that is a bill which is largely about taking new powers. One of the things that was consulted on for that bill, for example, was about taking the powers so that we can put charges on single-use items. For example, we're looking at those single-use beverage cups next as one of the things to look at in that single-use space. But that bill is intended to take powers so that we can then be adaptable as we go forward and use targeted approaches, much like we all know was done on plastic bags, which is what we have under our current powers, and how very effective that was in reducing litter and damage to the environment.
Thank you, Convener.
Minister, before we conclude the evidence, is there anything else you would like to add?
No, just thanks very much to Callum for bringing this to our attention. He's absolutely right. We should all be working towards using fewer single-use plastics, using reusable long-term containers and packaging. So thanks to him so much for his work.
Cassie, Minister, and Laura, thank you very much for your time. And members, are we content to take the evidence at a further meeting?
Content.
Thank you. We'll suspend for a short while. Could I welcome everybody back to Citizens' Participation in Public Petitions Committee. We will now continue with considered petitions. The next petition is Petition 1862, Introduce Community Representation on Boards of Public Organisations Delivering Lifeline Services to Islands Communities, lodged by Rona Mackay, Angus Campbell and Naomi Bremner on behalf of the Youth Economic Task Force. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce community representation on boards of the public organisations delivering lifeline services to Ireland's communities, in keeping with the Ireland Scotland Act 2018. We were previously considered as a petition at our meeting on the 9th of November, where we agreed to write to the Minister for Transport to seek information on the progress of appointments to a board of David McBrain Limited and to seek an update on the communication between the Minister and Highlands and Islands Airport Limited, HAL, regarding the proposals put forward in this petition. I am pleased to say that we have now received a response from the Minister which sets out the details of the advertising campaign to recruit two non-executive directors on the board of David McBrain, and the Minister highlights that the understanding of island life is key to criteria for these roles, and this will be fully explored and assessed through the recruitment process. In relation to HAL, the Minister also notes that an understanding of the communities in which HAL airports are located is an essential requirement for all board members. It is also noted that HAL have recently recruited a new finance director, which has also been appointed to their board and is an island resident. The committee have also received a submission from our colleague Alistair Allen, MSP. Dr. Allen has reiterated his support for this petition and notes that while progress has been made, individual appointments to boards of HAL and CALMAC do not necessarily mean that issues have been resolved. Do any members have comments or suggestions?
Thank you, Convener. May I speak? Yeah. I have been approached by people about acknowledging that there has been some movement, but there's no great urgency to see it as a key priority. And I have been asked to raise with the committee that there should be a priority made to having an islander on HAL board. Beatrice Wishart, from Shetland has spoken to me just about how the community there feel it is absolutely imperative that that happens. So I just wanted to share that with the committee. Thank you.
Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think that there is progress being made here, but it still requires, I think, more information. And I would suggest that we might write to the Minister of Transport to encourage the Scottish Government to continue making progress on this issue that has already been raised by other MSPs and MSPs on this group here today, and recommend that they explore all available options to formalise the role of community representation on boards of public organisations, providing a lifeline service to island communities. And some of these organisations we've touched on in the past, Convener, when we talked about representation of HIAL or David McBride or CMAL. So I think these are the type of organisations that we should be requesting the Minister to give us more information on, and we can then, from that, we can then assess how the progress really is managing to go forward.
Thank you. Fergus Ewan?
Yes, I support the recommendation that Alexander Stewart has just made, but I would also add that the specific reference in the letter to the Minister could be made, and perhaps a copy appended of Alistair Allen's submission, because I think he makes several very good points about the value of having island residents on boards relating to ferries, to transportation, to health. And he goes into a couple of the reasons, which very briefly are that that organisations are improved by having people who personally rely on the services rather than outsiders who don't use the services. I mean, that's a very common sense point, and it seems to be a very practical example of the benefits that can come if you have local residents on these boards rather than, if you like, outsiders, without being pejorative. And secondly, having island-based board members would also make for a better flow of ideas, he says, from communities at an early stage rather than consultation taking place after decisions have basically been taken. I think that too is a very good point, Convener, and one that perhaps we could ask that the Minister bear in mind in relation to further future appointments to public bodies.
Thank you for that. Are we all agreed with these recommendations? Thank you. Our next petition is Petition 1862, Fast Track Future Adult Disability Payment Applications for People Undergoing Cancer Treatment, lodged by Wendy Swan. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to create a separate department within the Social Security Scotland that will fast-track future adult disability payments applications for people with cancer diagnosed while they are undergoing treatment. At our last consideration of the petition, the committee agreed to the Social Security Agency, highlighting the concerns of the petitioner and the recommendations of assistant improvements set out by McCallum Cancer Support. In response, the Scottish Social Security Agency has confirmed that it will publish statistics routinely on a quarterly basis, and that the information available will be expanded as they continue to collect more data. This will include information on processing times. The response outlines its works to address the issues raised by McCallum Cancer Support recommendations. The petition of recent submissions highlights ongoing concern about rejections and applications for disability payments we've put. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think that we have already asked some questions about this petition in the past, and we have received some assurances, but I still think there are a number of areas that we might still want to ask, and it might be advantageous to write to the Social Security Scotland to ask whether it intends to set these targets, because I think the targets being set is the vitally important process we have here when an application process and the timing of the application for both special and normal rule cases, because if we can get that, then we will get an answer as to where we are, and if that is the case, then there are other options that can be looked at thereafter.
Thank you. Does everybody agree with that? Thank you. Our next petition is Petition 1919, Prohibit the Sale of High Caffeine Products to Children for Performance Enhancement, lodged by Ted Gourlay. This petition calls on the Scottish Government to urge the Scottish Government to ban the sale of fast-release caffeine gum to under-18s for performance enhancement due to risk of serious harm. We last considered the petition at our meeting on the 28th of September, where we agreed to the Scottish Government to seek information on when the report on the consultation on ending the sale of energy drinks to children and young people will be published. We have now received this response from the Scottish Government, which states that we will publish an independent consultation analysis report and set out our policy response in due course. The Scottish Government response also suggests that evidence based in relation to caffeine, especially caffeine gum, continues to develop, and they will look to the European Food Safety Authority and others as this evidence base involves to consider the implications on the current advice of caffeine products. At this stage, the Scottish Government is not considering a ban on the sale of fast-release caffeine products to under-18s. We have also received two submissions from the petitioner, Ted Gourley, in which he raises concerns about a lack of available evidence to understand the impact of high-strength, fast-release caffeine products on athletes of various ages. Mr Gourley also offers suggestions for further information governed by this committee, as well as drawing our attention to advice that the US Anti-Doping Agency provides in relation to caffeine. Do any members have suggestions? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think we are writing to the Scottish Government requesting an update on when the analysis report and policy response to the consultation into ending the sale of energy drinks to children and young people will be published. I would also suggest that we recommend that they commission further research into effects of fast-release caffeine products on children and young people, particularly those participating in physical activity. And it might also be useful to seek some clarity from the UK Athletics to seek their views on where we are in this whole raised by the petition, because the information on any action they are undertaking to address the potential risks to athletes under 18 using fast-release caffeine products for performance enhancement, that may also give us an indication as to how it is being managed and processed by the UK Athletics. Thank you, Convener.
Fergus Sheehan.
Just to, in backing that recommendation, I did note that it is stated in the information that we have that there have been sudden cardiac deaths at races where caffeine gum was promoted, although there are no investigations of any potential link. And Scottish Athletics and Sports Scotland warned of health risks. So just mention that because, plainly, you know, if cardiovascular risks are involved and death has occurred, then this is a very serious matter. So I think we should get this further evidence in some detail.
Carol?
Yeah, I would support that. If the athletics associations are already looking at this, then I think bringing the evidence to the committee would be very worthwhile.
Thank you for that, colleagues. Are we all in agreement? Thank you. Our next petition is petition 1926, expand universal free school meals for all nursery, primary and secondary school pupils, lodged by Alison Dowling. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to expand universal free school meal provision for all nursery, primary and secondary school pupils. Our last consideration of a petition on the 28th of September, we agreed to write to Cabinet Secretary for Education and Schools, seeking an update on the work being undertaken to expand the provision of free schools, specifically where priority has been given to extending the provision to pupils in secondary school. In response, the Cabinet Secretary notes that £30 million of capital funding has been allocated to support the expansion of catering and dining facilities to help plan for expansion of free school meals to pupils in primaries 6 and 7. The Cabinet Secretary also states that the Scottish Government's commitment to a pilot of free school meals in secondary schools to support the consideration of further expansion. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Fergus?
Well, the £30 million is welcome, but you know, what's it being spent on and when and what's the timetable? So can we write to the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills to seek further information on the planned pilot of free school meals in secondary schools, especially the anticipated timescale for carrying out of the pilot?
Carol?
Yeah, it's probably on a very similar point. I think it's very disappointing that we don't have a time frame. There has been commitments made around school meals. There is a growing body, you know, evidence body that this is an important important policy to take forward. There has been made commitments and nothing has come forward. So I think we should, you know, strongly word a letter to the Minister to ask exactly, can they please set out the time frame for this?
Thank you, colleagues. Are we all in agreement with these recommendations? Thank you. Our next petition is petition 1934, make lessons on gender-based violence mandatory for all year groups in high schools, launched by Craig Sugler, on behalf of Grenfell's High School Rights and Equalities Committee. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to work with Education Scotland to develop an educational resource on gender-based violence for all year groups in high school. This resource should educate on the causes of gender-based violence and ensure that young people leave school with the tools to help create a safer society for women. At last consideration of the petition, the committee agreed to write to Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills. It also agreed to write to COSLA. Following our last consideration of this petition, we requested information from COSLA on the current provision on gender-based violence lessons across local authorities. COSLA's response details a number of ongoing work streams which are being delivered by schools in partnership with local rape crisis centres and Rape Crisis Scotland. The Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills' recent submission states that recording and monitoring of incidents in schools is essential, emphasising the importance on the consistency and uniform approach. The local authority owns the tool CMIS provides a function to record instances of sexual harassment, and evaluation was due to take place in 2022 to access the success of the system. The submission also highlights upcoming reviews of PSE and prevention practices. Do any members have any conclusions or submission?
Thank you, Convener. I think that we need to write to COSLA to ask which three local authorities are yet to roll out the Mentor Violence Prevention Programme in secondary schools, requesting information about what the challenges have been, preventing the details of work. I think it's also to ask what challenges face local government in embedding school-based provision for violence against. And I think also to write to Rape Scotland Crisis to request information on its reporting mechanisms for the Equality Sale of School strategy, whether it plans work with local authorities has resulted in an increase in activities across Scotland. I think these would be very useful for us to try and get some more clarity, Convener, on where we are in this whole process, because as you've indicated in your opening, this is an immensely important, and if it's embedded at school level, then it stops any and prevents once they've left.
Thank you for that, Alexander Stewart. Carol Morgan.
Yeah, I'm interested. Obviously, we know, all of us will be aware, within the Parliament there has been significant debates and discussion on violence against women and girls. I just wondered if we have any information about whether any of the other committees have done any work around this, around education, about, you know, either in the Justice Committee or in the Education Committee. I'd just be interested to look at that evidence.
I'm sure we could find that out.
That'd be great. Thank you.
Okay. On Alexander Stewart's recommendations, are we all agreed? Thank you, committee. We now move onto agenda item 3, consideration of new petitions. I will give this item, as I normally do, by saying that before committee considers a new petition, we request an initial view on the petition from the Scottish Government, as well as a briefing from the Parliament's Impartial Research Service, SPICE. Our first new petition today is Petition 1969, Amend the Law to Fully Decriminalise Abortion in Scotland, lodged by Gemma Clark. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to bring forward legislation to fully decriminalise abortion services in Scotland and make provision to ensure that abortion services are available up to 24 weeks of pregnancy across all parts of Scotland. Gemma highlights that while the Abortion Act 1967 sets out criteria to making abortion permissible, such as a requirement for two doctors' signatures, does not explicitly decriminalise abortion. This, Gemma believes, leaves women open to risk of prosecution if they choose to end the pregnancy. In responding to a petition, the Scottish Government makes clear the review that all women should be able to access abortion services as set down within the limits of the law where they wish. The Government's response also makes reference to work being undertaken with NHS boards to ensure services of up to 24 weeks are established in Scotland, as well as support being provided to Gillian Mackay MSP in drafting her Members' Bill on safe access zones for abortion services. While the Scottish Government has indicated that they may be open to reviewing the law on abortion in the future, they have no immediate plans to amend the Abortion Act 1967. The committee has also received a submission from the Scottish Feminist Policy and Advocacy Organisation in Gender, which briefly sets out their argument in supporting the decriminalisation of abortion. Members should be aware, as highlighted in both the briefings we have received from SPICE and the Scottish Government's response, that the Offence Against the Persons Act 1861 mentioned in the petition does not apply in Scotland. Do members have any suggestions or comments, please? Carol Mockin.
Thanks. Yeah, I mean, I'm quite supportive of the general, you know, principles behind the petition about decriminalising abortion. I think in a modern society, it seems right that that 1967 Abortion Act be updated. So I would be interested to know why the government are saying they're supportive, but they haven't set out any plans to do that. So I wondered if we could explore that. I know that certainly the medical support behind changing that is there. So I think it would be interesting just to make sure that we have all that information. So yeah, I would like us to take the petition forward if we can.
I'm just wondering if we could also write to several stakeholders involved here to seek their views on the actions it's called for in the petition, like the British Pregnancy Advisory Service, Sexual Health Scotland, British Medical Association, Scottish Human Rights Commission, Abortion Rights Scotland, faith organisations, Under Faith Scotland, Society for the Protection of Unborn Child, and the Humanist Society Scotland, if the committee is agreed. Alexander Stewart.
Convener, I think it's vitally important that we collate as much information on this topic, and as you've indicated, by contacting a number of these agencies and organisations, they will be able to give their views on any action that may be required, and I think that will give us a much better and a more holistic approach as to how we would challenge this petition, because as Carol Mockin has already said, it requires updating, it requires to be looked at, because you know it's been decades since this has been examined in this way. So by putting this together and by collecting that information, we'll have a much better picture as to how that is being processed across these organisations in Scotland as well.
Is the committee all agreed with these recommendations? Thank you very much. Our next new petition is petition 1984, introduce C100 form for child arrangement orders in Scotland, lodged by Amy Stevenson. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to reduce financial barriers that prevent parents from having contact with their children by introducing a Scottish equivalent to C100 form with a fixed fee for making applications for child residence or child contact orders. Members may recall that we have previously considered a petition from Amy Stevenson which focuses on the provision of legal aid to parents fighting for access to their children. Amy has followed up that petition with this call for an introduction of a form similar to C100 form used in England and Wales when applying to the court for a child arrangement order. Amy suggests that introducing a similar form in Scotland, along with a fixed fee for submitting it, would help reduce the financial burden on parents seeking child residence or contact orders. In response to a petition, the Scottish Government set out the current process for application to a court for child residence and contact orders and the fees associated with it. While accepting that the existing procedures for lodging writs and defence in Scotland are viewed as difficult to understand, the Scottish Government also highlights a range of issues that would require to consider before moving to a form-based system. This includes circumstances that the C100 form is too lengthy and can be difficult for vulnerable applicants to complete without assistance. The form may not capture all the relevant issues for a court to consider, and the concerns that a form-based approach may not be focused on the best interest of the child. It's also noted that a form-based process may reduce costs at an initial application stage, but would not rule out the need for applicants to assess legal advice or other stages of the process. The committee has also received a submission from Shane Payton Scotland and Clare Baker MSP, copies which have been included in our meeting papers. And I would briefly highlight Shane Payton Scotland have suggested that the introduction of a C100 form or similar would remove some barriers for parents who are trying to restore or establish a schedule of contact with their children, but that wider improvements are necessary to provide parents in these circumstances. Do members have any suggestions or comments? Alexander Stewart.
I think this is very important, convener, because there are areas that we've heard in the submission and we've already received, but I think we need to get more information. And I think it's important that we write to the Scottish Government highlighting the online system that have been introduced in Australia and in the Netherlands, and seeks information on what considerations have been given to developing a similar service here for parents who've separated in Scotland. I think that would be very useful for us to collate that information from these other organisations in other countries who have put that in place. And it also might be quite useful for us to find out from some, once again, of the organisations that we have here in Scotland, for example, the Law Society, the Family Law Association, Scottish Legal Aid Board, the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Services, the Relationship Scotland and the Family Law Committee on Scottish Civil Justice Council, to seek their views to find out where we can take this petition. I would suggest these following recommendations, convener.
Are the members agreed with that? Thank you. Our next new petition is petition PE 1985, Evaluate Garage to Home Developments, lodged by Dan Loftus. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to commission an independent evaluation and provide national guidance on garages to home developments. The Scottish Government's response to the petition notes that the process Garage to Homes project meets the Council's local housing strategy objectives, and that this is supported by both the Scottish Borders Council and the South of Scotland Enterprise. It states that homes will be permanently high-quality homes designed for wheelchair users and or people with limited mobility. On the issue of community engagement, it highlighted a public consultation in November 2022 and plans for consultation events in the future. The submission concludes by stating that the Scottish Government does not prescribe nor enforce particular housing solutions, but rather it provides a planning framework against which developments are tested. The petitioner's reaction, recent submission asks, is the aspiration of the Scottish Parliament to move the citizens, specifically older adults, and the people with disabilities into housing units converted from garages. His submission questions the quality and feasibility study of the project, stating that no social factors or identifiable local housing needs were factored into the study. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, convener. I think we need to write to the Scottish Government to seek some more clarity what consideration is given to the national impact of garages to homes developments in Scottish borders, or whether it believes that a broader evaluation of such development is required, and whether it recognises the value of assessing factors such as social impact as part of any evaluation of such developments. And it would also possibly be an opportunity to get COSLA's view and seeking their views on the petition for a planning and local authority perspective. I think that would also give us a flavour as to how they see this whole process, convener.
Alexander Stewart, has the committee agreed with him? Thank you. Our next new petition is petition PE 1986, Provide Testing Kits for Drugs in Public Spaces, lodged by Andy Patterson on behalf of Help Not Harm campaign. Petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to provide free testing kits for drugs in public spaces such as local pharmacies, libraries and universities' buildings. Spife briefing for this petition highlights the recommendations of the Scottish Drugs Deaths Task Force, which states that drug testing should be supported and existing check-in facilities should be reviewed to ensure they are open, transparent and accessible. The briefing points to research project into licensed drug checking facilities, which is due to report in January 2023, and another related to a project which is due to conclude in March 2023. The Scottish Government submission shares its reservations about the simplicity of the proposed testing kits put forward in this petition. It highlights the planned establishment of drug checking services in Dundee, Aberdeen and Glasgow through its upcoming pilots. This approach includes laboratory testing, links to other drug services and provides wider public health information about drugs in circulation. Do members have any comments or actions? Ferguson?
Yes, I would suggest we write to the Scottish Government to ask for a number of things. A summary of the evaluation report and programme of implementation on licensed drug checking facilities, an update on the status of its licence application to the Home Office for the establishment of drug checking facilities, to ask who the target service users are for the facilities pilot, and request information on how health boards will engage with those groups. And finally, to ask what considerations have been given to ensure that drug checking facilities will be made accessible to people who are not already in touch with other health services, especially young adults, as highlighted by the Scottish Drugs Death Task Force.
Does anybody have any other? Not if we all agreed with that. Thank you very much. Our next new petition is petition PE 1987, amend the Scotland Act 2016 to automatically trigger a by-election if an MSP councillor leaves their party, lodged by James Cassidy. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to amend the Scotland Act 2016 to automatically trigger a by-election by compelling an MSP or councillor to resign if they leave the party they were elected under. The Scottish Government's response to the petition states that the terms of its own membership is a matter for the Scottish Parliament. On the issue of councillors, the Scottish Government states that there is no current plans to change the electoral system in the way the petition is calling for. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think that in reality, we've heard that there's no need or there's no information coming forward that this is going to be a reality. So I would suggest that we close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders on the basis that the Scottish Government does not plan to change the electoral system to prevent a councillor from remaining in post following their resignation from a political party they are representing when elected.
Thank you. Does any other members have any comments? Are we agreed with the recommendations? Thank you. The next new petition is petition PE 1991, Develop an Educational Resource on Abortion, also lodged by Gemma Clark. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to work with Educational Scotland to develop a health-focused and stigma-challenging educational resource on abortion and make it available to all secondary schools in Scotland. Gemma believes it is essential for all young people to receive medical, accurate and health-focused education on abortion, and that challenging the stigma around abortion is also essential for well-rounded sexual health curriculum. In a written submission in support of her petition, Gemma has also raised concerns about anti-abortion groups visiting schools and the importance of ensuring young people are provided with factual information regarding their health care. The Scottish Government have responded in this petition, as they often do in these cases, to state that the curriculum is not mandatory. They do not, however, share details of relationships, sexual health and parenthood resources that are available to teachers. It is also noted that these resources have been developed and peer-reviewed in partnership with educators, health professionals and the first sector organisations, with intention of providing young people with learning about this factual objective, in which enables them to make informed choices about their sexual health and well-being. The committee has also received submissions from the Humanist Society Scotland, a joint letter from the British Pregnancy Advisory Service, Back Off Scotland and the Scottish Teachers for Positive Change of Wellbeing. These submissions are broadly supportive of the petitioner's aim to ensure pupils receive medically accurate and health-focused education on abortion. Do members have any comments or suggestions? Carol Mochan.
Thanks, Convener. Yeah, I am broadly supportive of the petition, and I have been approached by other members in the Parliament to suggest that we could seek to find out some further information on what actually happens within the school education system, and you know how we could support proper education around this quite sensitive, often sensitive issue for young people at schools, young women in particular. So I would be keen to see if we could get together some of the information and see how it is actually taken up in the school curriculum.
Any other suggestions, colleagues? I wonder if we could write to organisations including COSLA, Association of Directors of Education in Scotland, the General Teaching Council for Scotland, the Scottish Catholic Education Service and Society for Protection of an Unborn Child to seek their views on the issues raised within the petition. Are we all agreed? We now move on to our final new petition for today, petition 1992, Dual Way 9, Improve Road Safety, lodged by Laura Halster. And can I welcome Murdo Fraser MSP and Rhoda Grant, a regular visitor MSP, to committee today. A petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to deliver on the commitment it made in 2011 and address the safety concerns on the A9 by publishing a revised timetable and detailed plan for dualling each section, completing the dualling of the work by 2025, and creating a memorial to those who have lost their lives in the road traffic accidents on the A9. We are joined in consideration for a petition by MSP's colleagues, Murdo Fraser and Rhoda Grant, and I welcome you both. I should probably begin by saying that this petition has now been somewhat superseded by the Minister of Transport statement in Parliament on the 8th of February, in which it was confirmed that a 2005 completion date is now no longer available. Nevertheless, I will set out some of the background before opening up to wider discussion. In the background information to a petition, the petitioner, Laura Hulsters, tells us that the A9 Dueling Action Group was formed to raise awareness of a number of people who have lost their lives on the A9 and the need for a mandatory safety feature to be deployed to help reduce the further loss of life, as well as to explore whether there should be an investigation into procurement procedures associated with this project. In its initial response to a petition received prior to a minister's statement, the Scottish Government highlighted the short-term road safety measures that had been developed by Transport Scotland to take account of a recent trend of fatal accidents on the A9. The response also states that the Scottish Government's firm commitment to compelling the dualling of A9 between Perth and Inverness without providing a revised timetable and when this work is likely to be completed. Following the minister's statement, the committee have received a submission from the petitioner in which he calls on us to consider a public inquiry into the matter. And I would actually open it up to members first, and I'll come to Ferguson.
Yes, hey, thank you, Convener, and I commend Laura Hansler for bringing this petition to Parliament, and I believe that it's been signed by several thousand people. Last year, Convener, there were 13 people who lost their lives in incidents on the A9, and 12 of those occurred on sections of the A9 which are single carriageway. I think there is evidence that the risk of fatality or incapacitating injuries as a result of incidents is three times greater on single carriageway than dual carriageway, and 10 times greater on single than motorway. There are no dual carriageway links in the Highlands, and therefore for a Highlander, a Highland resident, the chance of dying on the road is between 3 and 10 times greater than those living in the Central Belt. Every death has been a tragedy for families and has caused absolute devastation. And I just mention that because that is the backdrop which has brought representatives from all parties, I think, or nearly all parties, to the conclusion that we really need to get to the bottom of what is happening here. So my suggestion, Convener, is that there should be a parliamentary inquiry. Perhaps the Net Zero and Transport Committee, if it wishes and has the time so to do, could be approached privately to see if this is an inquiry that they are able to undertake, given their busy work schedule. If they are not able to undertake it, I would suggest that this committee carry out such an inquiry. But I think the important point I'm making is that an inquiry is required. Why? Well, I think there's really several questions, but the two main ones that, and I'd be interested to hear what Murdo Fraser and Rhoda Grant say, is because I think we have actually been working across party on this, which is good, and with the Liberal Democrats as well, I should say. But I think the two questions are, you know, what exactly went wrong with Tamatan Moy? I mean, it was announced that it would be going ahead back, I think, in around the spring of 2021, and it was only fairly recently that we heard it wasn't going ahead. So what happened in that intervening period? And why did it go wrong? And will a re-tender actually solve the problem, or could it lead to the same situation happening again, with apparently only one bidder being left at a price which was reported to be unacceptably high? The second and the main question, really, and this is the thrust of my recommendation, Convener, is that the scope of that inquiry should be, how do we most swiftly complete the dualling of the A9 between Perth and Inverness? How can that be done, and what procurement options and choices should be carried out? I have had extensive discussions with people in the civil engineering sector, including the Chartered Engineers Contractors Association, CECA, who are the representative body. And these discussions have led me to the conclusion that the industry believe that if things proceed at the moment, where we are procuring one section consecutively after another and only doing one at a time, then given it takes 3 years minimum, actually, for each section, 1 year to procure and 2 years to build, and there are nine remaining sections. Nine threes are 27. 27 plus 2023 is 2050. The prospect of this road not being dualled by 2050 is utterly, utterly unacceptable to, I think, all parties and certainly my constituents and the Highlanders. However, and this is the last point I'll make, convener, because I appreciate you've given me some latitude here. This very same industry senior insiders tell me that if everything is done and the capacity is there to do it, the companies are there to do it, if they can be persuaded to do it by Transport Scotland, but if everything is done as it could be done, as swiftly as it can be done, the completion of the duelling could be around 2030. So the key is the procurement options. And Transport Scotland, I think, recognise that the current model of procurement, where all the risks are passed to the contractors, results in the situation that one company left Scotland entirely, one company stopped bidding for roads, leaving a limited pool of potential bidders from whom competitive bids can be required. In that circumstance, competitive bidding may well lead to the scenario again that there is no competitive bids, particularly since it costs about £500,000 to prepare a bid and you have four or five companies doing the same work four or five times over. So a framework contract, which is applicable in Highways England, I understand, and some local authorities and Scottish Water, would seem to be the way ahead, which will allow several sections of the road and also parts of the A96, which should also be duelled, and the duelling of which from Smithton to Aldern, including the Nairn bypass, is again a government commitment, can be agreed. So I think an inquiry into all of these things by a parliamentary committee would allow us all display forensic, critical, but supportive questioning of Transport Scotland, of the Minister, of industry figures, in order to get this done. Because, frankly, the people in the Highlands and throughout Scotland have been really frustrated and in many cases angry that the pledge that the Scottish Government made has not been kept, and furthermore, that there hasn't even been an apology for that.
Thank you, Fergus Ewan. Murdo Fraser, would you like to comment?
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for letting me come to the committee this morning. And I should just start by saying I endorse everything that my friend Fergus Ewing has said, and he's absolutely right to say that there is a strong, you know, cross-party concern on this issue. My colleague, Jamie Halker-Johnson, apologises he would have been here this morning to support the petition, but has been detained elsewhere. I think we're having a debate on this issue in the Chamber this afternoon, so I'll say more about the matter then. But just briefly to summarise, I have a strong personal interest in the matter. More than 30 years ago, I was involved in a head-on collision on the A9 on a single carriageway section that left me with multiple fractures and spending weeks in hospital recovering. I was one of the lucky ones because many others who've been involved in similar accidents have not survived, as Fergus Ewing made very clear with the stark figures we've seen just for the last year, with 12 people dying on single carriageway sections. And there is little doubt that had we had a dual carriageway with central barriers between the different lanes, we would not have seen the same level of serious fatality and accident as we have seen on the A9. So it is a crucial issue from a road safety perspective. There was a lot of celebration in the Highlands and across the area I represent, Mid-Scotland, you know, Perth and Kinross in particular, when the current Scottish Government announced, I think in 2011, a timetable for progressing the A9 duelling project to complete by 2025. We know that's not now happening, and that was confirmed by the Minister just 2 weeks ago. But I think it is important that we keep the pressure on to press for a completion date, and we better understand what the reasons are why we cannot see faster progress. So I entirely endorse the call for a parliamentary inquiry to be done by a committee of this Parliament that can drill down to these issues and ensure we have a proper understanding of what exactly is holding up this vital road safety project, which, if it doesn't progress, sadly, we are just going to see more fatalities over the next few years.
Thank you, Madam Fraser. Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, and I too want to thank the committee for allowing me to come and speak to this petition, and I agree with what colleagues have already said. And the A9 is a road that isn't just impacting on constituents in Inverness. It impacts on the whole of the Highlands and Islands, and I pay tribute to Lorna Hansler as well for bringing forward this petition, and indeed all those that are campaigning to improve this road. A lot of people say there is no such thing as a dangerous road, that it's only dangerous drivers. But the road plays a huge part in mitigating driver error. And, you know, I think everyone can admit to driver error at one point or another, but the design of the road keeps people safe. I've driven the road, I drive the road weekly, and I see very strange driver behaviour. And most of it would not have happened if it had been a dual carriageway. Last year, there were 8 deaths in the 25-mile stretch near the Slocht in just 3 months, and that was tragic, with a total amount of deaths in last year was 13. And these people are losses not only to their families, but their communities. And indeed, we all lose out from their contribution to society. So this impacts on everybody. The SNP made this a manifesto commitment back in 2007. In December 2011, ministers confirmed the commitment and they put the time frame of 2025 on it at that point. But sadly, progress is slow. And I don't believe that the war in Ukraine or Brexit or COVID or inflation, because of all those issues, is the issue underlying that. Because had that target of 2025 actually been a goal, those contracts would have already been issued, the land would have been purchased, we would be probably on the last stretch rather than looking towards the third stretch. So we have still 11 sections of the road to be dualled and no time frame for them. And the closest time frame we've had is the one that Fergus Young alluded to, where an industry representative has said 2050. And I would even say it might even be longer than that, because the stretches that have been dualled have not been done back to back. There's been gaps between that work. So we really need an investigation into this. And even if you look at the cost to the public purse, every fatality costs about £2 million to investigate. So last year, £26 million. You know, including the loss of life, and then that's the loss to the public purse as well. So I'm keen to see an inquiry. Like Fergus, I think it would be worthwhile the committee seeing if the Net Zero Committee had space to do that. But I also wonder if it's maybe something that this committee would want to get its teeth into and carry out an inquiry, because you maybe have the scope. And I know it's something the committee likes to do from time to time, is to take an issue that a petitioner has brought forward and look into it. So I wonder if you would consider that. But certainly a committee of this parliament carrying out a thorough inquiry that would tell us what's gone wrong, what progress has actually been made, and give us some realistic timescales.
Thank you, Rhoda Grant. I am just wondering, members, if in the instance the clerks can continue to discuss with Net Zero Committee on the possibility of an inquiry, but in the meantime we continue to gather evidence on this, and I would suggest that we invite the petitioner to provide evidence to the committee, and also invite the Transport Minister to provide evidence to the committee in future meetings, if that's acceptable by committee members. Alexander Stewart.
I think that is very acceptable. I think we need the strength of view and the strength of feeling of this is so immense. As you, we've already found out today, there is cross-party support. There are thousands of individuals who have made this petition part of their process. And there is no doubt that there's been a neglect within this process. That's coming through very, very strong from the petitioner. So I think having the petitioner here would give us much more clarity. I also think your idea of making the Transport Minister come as well would also be very useful. But I think it's also, we need to get information from other organisations that are affected by this whole process. And I think organisations like the Society of Chief Officers of Transport in Scotland have an impact to play in this. We also think about the Chartered Institute of Highways and Transport. They have a role, and even the Road College Association, because these are the individuals whose members or organisations are using the road and are suffering from the process that we've heard very eloquently from MSPs this morning about what the dangers are on this road and the possibilities they have. So I think the more information we can get here, and I like the idea of this committee maybe considering something if it's not possible to take it to another committee of the Parliament. I think that could be investigated by the clerks, as you suggest, but we should not lose sight that this committee has an opportunity and an area that we might want to do ourselves to ensure that that's the case, convener. So that would be my suggestions as well as your own.
Thank you, Alexander Stewart. Fergus-Ewan?
Yes, I mean, if there's an appetite, as and I obviously have the appetite, as do others, to, for this committee to do the inquiry, I think we would be well placed to do it, actually. And I do know the Net Zero Committee are very busy, but I think because they're the lead committee, it would be politic to have discussions. But, you know, personally, I think Alexander Stewart's right. I think we could do a good job, and we would be assisted by visiting members, I'm perfectly sure. So I would be more than happy if this Petitions Committee did it. In some ways, practically, it might be easier for us to play a part. Could I just say that I think also we should write to the Chambers of Commerce, possibly Inverness and Perth, who have been very active in this, the Association of Community Councils, and can supply the clerks with information about who to write to in Badenoch and Strathspey, for example. I think Sandy McCook chairs a group of the community councils there, and also the Chartered Engineers Contractors Association, who I know can provide expert evidence. So it would be good to contact them, and I should apologise to my constituents that I'm not able to attend the debate on the A9 this afternoon, because I will be in the dental chair having my teeth drilled. I hope it's nobody connected with Transport Scotland doing the drilling. So it will be a bit like perhaps not Hamlet without the Prince, but probably, since I'm counting my age, Hamlet without Polonius perhaps, but Laertes will be there to fill the breach, convener. So I just thought I should state that out of courtesy, because normally I do participate in all these debates, and it's a matter of disappointment that I wasn't able to do so because I couldn't get any other appointment. So just to state that for the record, and of courtesy to other members who might wonder why I'm not making my views known. Thank you.
Thank you, Fergus-Ewan. Are the committee happy with his recommendations? Thank you. Can I say thank you to Murdo Fraser, to Rhoda Grant for her attendance today? And that concludes the public session of this meeting this morning. And our next meeting will be on Wednesday, the 8th of March, 2023, and we'll move into private session.